covering the High Plains with news, weather, and information. From TV 23 Studios in Sublette, this is High Plains Today.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to this special edition of High Plains Today. I'm joined today by Representative Shannon Francis, District 125, Kansas State House of Representatives. That's why he's called a representative. Yeah, good to see you today.
It's good to see you, Chris.
I always enjoy when you come by and talk to us.
Well, thanks.
You know, you're getting ready to go back to Topeka.
We are. We go back Sunday.
Yep. The, as they call it, I don't know why, it's called the veto session. Why? I don't know. But you guys are going back to wrap up the session for this year, correct?
Right. Historically, you've passed all of your legislation by the beginning of April, and then you come back afterwards to consider any bills that the governor's overridden. Over time, as our financial situations got worse, we've waited to see what consensus revenue estimates are in April 20th and see what the final numbers are for April, so we know exactly how much money we have to raise or how much we have to cut.
So here during the last few years, though, it really hasn't been a veto session, has it?
No.
It's been more of a, holy mackerel, we gotta get stuff done.
Yeah. You know, as the financial condition of the state's worsened, it's become, again, more and more important to know what our revenues are and our expenses are so we can fine-tune the budget and fine-tune
the
cuts.
Well, now, the revenue guys, I will give the state, you guys, or the committee or whoever does that, though, since they went back and redid the projections, now we're still in a hole, but they're closer. So it doesn't look as bad, you know, because what, you missed 12 or 14 months there for a while, yeah. But now they're getting closer. They're still not great, but at least the projections are closer, right?
Well, if you lower the bar far enough, sooner or later, you're going to be able to get over it. And I think that's what's happened ever since the tax cuts of 2012. There's been a lot of changes in the tax code. Obviously, the economy in rural Kansas has fallen off, and it's become real difficult for them to estimate those numbers, both with the changes in the structure of our tax system and with our economy.
Okay, but let me ask you, before we get into the nitty-gritty of, you know, what's really happening, what's going to take place, you know, this year, new leadership.
Yes.
First time in the House
yes.
in a long time. How's
right.
that going?
It's going great. It's going great. You know, we've got a new speaker. We've got a new majority leader. We've got new members throughout leadership. We've got a new tax chair, a new appropriations chair, and they're doing a great job. They're really, really focused on process, making sure that everybody has a seat at the table and try and find the best solution that they can get the necessary votes on to get it out of the legislature and to the governor's desk.
Well, and the other good thing is because now Speaker of the House
yes.
is Ron Reichman from Northeast Kansas. But he grew up in Meade, so he kind of has a feel
that's right.
for this part of the state, right?
Yep. The majority leader's from Dighton, which is just north.
Right. Don Heineman, right?
Right.
Okay.
And then the Speaker Pro Tem is actually, he grew up in Great Bend. His name's Scott Schwab. He, again, lives in the Olathe, Johnson County area. But, yeah, they all have rural Kansas roots, and I think that helps a lot. And again, I think they're really interested in having an open process where everybody has a seat at the table. They know that we've got a very diverse legislature this year, and that's the way to get things done is to make sure everybody feels included.
Well, plus there's a lot of new, I mean, there's a lot of rookies.
There is.
Or freshmen, is. Whatever you want, rookies, I like rookies.
So there's a lot of education that has to happen, but even with all of that education that needed to happen this year, it's been a real productive session. You know, we passed some bills that I think are important to Western Kansas. For instance, we did some change on weight limits for truckers hauling agricultural products. We did some changes to a new concept from the Department of Agriculture called water conservation areas to make mm-hmm. those so that they'd work better. You know, water is one of the most important things that we have in Western Kansas. And, you know, there was a lot of work done. I'm on water and environment. To try to get some additional funding to the state water plan. One of the things that's affected water funding in our state with this budget crisis is $8 million that normally came from EDIF, which was lottery money. and $6 million that came from the general fund no longer flows into the water fund. So they've got some serious budget shortages. And in that committee, we worked on priorities for water. We're still hoping we can get a smidgen of funding from the state general fund. We don't have that worked out yet.
Smidgen? Just a smidgen. Smidgen? Just a little smidge. But I will say this year, you know, that you haven't heard with the new leadership and stuff, press has not been as negative as it has been in the last 2-3 years, you know, since you got up there right. and all this mess started coming down the pike. I mean, it hasn't been as critical. The media hasn't been as critical of you guys this year, I don't think.
Well,
I mean, there's still problems,
that's right? That's right. That's right.
And there's still a big budget deficit, but.
That's right. Another thing that happens, too, is so often the press will focus on any crazy idea that gets introduced into a committee. Doesn't matter how much of a chance it really had to go forward, but you know, they like to focus on the crazier ideas that come out of committee. And for some reason, there haven't been as many just totally wild, crazy ideas thrown out
well,
this
maybe
year.
That helps. That helps. It maybe, does. Maybe that shows that you guys are getting maybe a little more level-headed. Suppose?
I think we have a lot of legislators that got elected this year based upon fixing the problems that Kansas faces. They're not up there for ideology. They're up there to make the trains run on time.
Okay. All right. Stay right there. We're going to take a quick break. We get back. We're going to start talking about the big elephant in the room. We're going to start talking about the budget and the deficit.
Okay.
All right. Stick around. Shannon and I'll be back right after this.
You're watching High Plains Today on TV 23 with host Chris Jewell. TV23's internet service and 4G live streaming provided by United Wireless. Coverage you deserve. Service you expect. United Wireless.
And welcome back. I'm joined today by Representative Shannon Francis, District 125, Kansas House of Representatives. All right. Now, so we're talking about a lot of things that are going on in Topeka.
Sure.
We were talking about a lot of the good things, the new leadership, a lot of new members in the House and
yes.
the Senate both. But you guys go back now. You got the veto session coming up. And you guys will be up there until you're done, basically, now, right?
Right?
There isn't that, we got to be done by next Thursday. That's not going to happen.
Right.
So the big thing is, though, you're going to have to start talking about the budget deficit, right? Because we're at, what, $420-some million?
Right. Right.
Okay.
So couple of things. I think appropriations has a lot of their work done. One of the things that did go through the House, and I hope it gets the governor's signature, is a restoration of the Medicaid cuts that we passed to providers. I believe it was last year. You know, one of the problems we have with Medicaid, for instance, is finding providers that will help the recipients based upon the fee schedule that we have. So we've restored some of those cuts that this year, and that happened through appropriations. I think with that exception, appropriations has most of their work done until we finalize tax and K-12 budget. So those are the elephants in the room, so to speak, is K-12 budget and tax.
Okay, so $422 million, I mean, that's maybe somebody else's walking around money, but not for the state of Kansas.
Right.
So, all right, so there's nothing left to take out of the bank of KDOT, is there?
Nothing left.
I mean, $400 million so far out of there.
Right.
We've delayed the payments to CAPERS, and we've delayed payments to schools.
Right. $64 million is the amount that we delayed to CAPERS this year. Now, when I talk about $422 million, I'm actually looking at the difference, as current law is, between revenues estimated for 2019 versus expenses estimated for 2019. It's like 522 for 18, and I can't remember the year that it is this year. You know, as I look at solutions that are going to affect Kansas, what I'm trying to look at is what our overall revenue stream is, less our anticipated expenses. And when I talk about that $422 million, one thing I don't have factored in there is the effect of the new K-12 budget plan. So, as you can see, we've got a real serious problem. And we have to look at the problem where we take out the one-time sweeps of funds here and there. We need to look at what we can do to make
okay, because the
work.
K. All right, so K-12.
Right.
You said you brought that up. Now, that's going to add to it, correct?
Without a doubt.
I mean, because you have a court decision out there that's looking
right.
you guys in the eye saying, you got to do something here.
So there's been two plans. Basically, the House education, the Senate hasn't started really working on education yet. The House plan that was originally started in the House would put an additional $150 million into K-12, and then it would have an inflation factor after that. As the House plan currently is in education, it would put in $150 million this year, $300 million next year, $450 the year after that, $600 the year after that. Finally, in the fifth year, it would ratchet up to about $750 million in additional funding. I've got real concerns about that plan. One, will we ever really fund it? You know, that's what's happened with education in the past is we pass these grand plans. We don't fund them. We don't have certainty for our school districts 2 or 3 years down the road, and we're back in court again. The courts did not issue an amount that we had to fund education. What they said is approximately 25% of the kids in Kansas aren't achieving, that we need to develop a funding formula that makes sure that funds are allocated to the 25% that aren't performing according to the Rose standards now, that they can reasonably be expected to meet the Rose standards. So I think it's disingenuous to say there's a dollar amount, but I do think there's a formula that has to make sure that we recognize this problem and we're working towards the solution.
I find that very ironic because, you know, what, 2 years ago,
right?
Block grants, we've got to have block grants.
Yep.
Okay,
bad idea.
You and I both agreed on that
a long time
ago. And got to get rid of this formula, it's too complicated. And now, what goes around comes around, we're coming back to a formula, and it may look a lot like the old formula, maybe.
And it should look a lot like the old formula because Kansas is a diverse state. We've got a diverse student body in our schools.
Every community is not the same.
That's right.
I don't know. Maybe a lot of those people don't understand that, you know, in the Northeast or the eastern part of the state, come out here and go, you know, we're not like a Blue Valley or we're not like, you know, Gardner or whatever.
Yeah, we've got school districts that have 12 in a senior class, and we've got school districts that have probably 2,500 in a senior class. We've got school districts that are, 50 or 60% full of children that English is not their primary language.
If not higher. Yes.
And then we've got school districts where everybody's mom and dad has a bachelor's or an upper level professional degree.
Yeah.
And we've got school districts where you've got to bus kids 30 miles to get there, and we've got school districts that are totally urban.
And that's a lot of those where you've got, you know, you're bussing kids 30, 40 miles, those are some of the ones that only have 12 kids in the senior class.
That's right. So, we've got school districts with extremely low valuations per student and school districts with huge valuations per student.
That'll be a big burden off you guys if you can get education figured out.
And then we know what the tax plan needs to be.
Yeah. And it just kind of disheartens me, though, that the Senate is sitting over there going, well, I don't know if we want to get started on this yet.
Well, and I don't think we need to paint them that way.
Well, I know, but that's the way it seems, though.
Right.
I mean, the House looks like you're trying to move forward because you had, you know, a budget plan for the governor, even though he vetoed it, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
And tried to move forward, and the Senate has just kind of been dragging.
Yeah, I think they've had a harder time building their consensus. I mean, I think there's a strong, you know, 80 to 85 votes in the House on most matters that really understand where we want to go. You know, in the Senate, I think they're a lot more diverse as far as they haven't formed that consensus yet.
All right. Stay right there.
Okay.
Come back. We're going to talk more about this because we're just getting started. Shannon and I will be back right after this. Welcome back to this special edition of High Plains Today. He is Representative Shannon Francis, District 125, Kansas House of Representatives. All right, we've been talking about a little bit about everything, but when we left off, we were talking about the budget deficit because you guys get back to Topeka, you're going to be working on the $420 plus million dollar deficit that the state is looking at. We've talked about education funding, you know, and there is a plan out there that over the next 5 years wants to be, build that up to an additional $750 million dollars. I don't know where that's going to come from.
Right.
You know, you've swept all these one-time funds. Right. We've sold off stuff. We've delayed payments.
Right.
So how do we get to zero?
Well, and that's what's hard because, again, our year-after-year revenues are somewhere in the neighborhood of $400, $450 million for the state general fund. We have to look at a tax plan, or excuse me, an education funding plan. You know, that $750 million number that's in the House right now, that means we've got a $1.2 billion deficit possibly in 5 years.
That's true. If you do the math, that's big. That's a B number.
I think our schools want certainty. I think they want to know what the rules are going to be. I'm concerned about that number because I'm not sure that the legislature will fund that. You know, sometimes more money is not the answer. And I want to look at it like you and your business. You know, if you've got a business and I tell you that I'm going to give you $1 million for your business this year, $2 million the year after, $3 million the year after that, $4 million the year after that, $5 million a year after that, let's say you're a farmer. You know, the first year you can probably spend that million without a doubt, quick. Maybe the second year. But at some point, you know, you need to take a deep breath and figure out where the best use of those resources is. So I want to make sure that our kids are adequately funded, but I also want to make sure that we do something sustainable that the legislature and the governor will fund.
I agree. Throwing money at it is not going to be the salvation for education.
We've got to develop programs.
Right.
And then we need to find out what those programs cost. With that being said, you know, the 2012 tax plan cut the top rate for all individuals from 6.45 to 4.6. That's a large amount of what our deficit is. The other part of it is what they always call the LLC fix, or the LLC exemption.
Loophole is a big word.
That's right.
Loophole.
You know, we have to address that. And again, you know, I've seen a bunch of different runs. I don't think Kansans want to go back to taxes being higher than they were before 2012, but I think they do understand that we overreached. So that's what's going to take up a lot of this veto session, is trying to find that consensus among the legislators of what we need to make things work.
Well,
you know, hey, also, you know, I want to address one other thing. There are people out there that say cut.
And I was going to ask you, I said, you've got a certain amount of people in Topeka and around the state that say, oh, you guys are just spend. You need to start cutting spending. Where are you going to cut it?
Well, you know, we've cut spending in the state of Kansas 9 times, I think they say, since 2008 or 2012. There are places you can cut. You can always become more efficient. But we're running from financial crisis to financial crisis up there. We can't make the long-term investments in the business of government to make it more efficient right now. Again, we're going from crisis to crisis. We have cut spending. We cut Medicaid reimbursements. We've cut spending on highway infrastructure by in excess of $400 million. We've kept spending level on schools. We've cut our universities. You know, and that's one of the things we do have to make a decision. If we don't want world-class universities in the state of Kansas, there's a lot of money we can cut at KU and K-State and Wichita State.
Wichita State, Pittsburgh State, Fort Hays.
But I'm not sure that's what most Kansans want is. I think they do appreciate the value that KU, K-State bring to the state of Kansas.
Oh, I think the entire state of Kansas is proud of all the state universities.
You have groups. The governor's been in office 6 years. He hasn't came up with the cuts. We spent $2 million on the Alvarez Marshall study.
I was going to ask you, yeah. And that was going to be what? Save $2 billion in
efficiencies? Over 5 years.
Yeah, how's that worked out?
Well, you know, we found some cuts, but nothing in the neighborhood of $2 billion that really works. The Truth Caucus in the House continues to talk about cuts, but they don't come up with real cuts. The fact of the matter is we've got a form of government that has a legislature, an executive branch, and a judiciary. We do have the rule of law in the state of Kansas. We've got to try to sell our case to the judiciary if we think there's too much spending on education. But, you know, we're a democracy, representative republic. We've got rules we have to follow, too. It's called the Constitution.
There you go. You know what? You're going to be in for some late nights when you get back to Topeka, aren't you?
Yeah, we are.
You're not all going to walk in and just go, oh, well, let's do this. Okay, we're done. We can go home now. It's not going to happen, is it?
No, it's hard to build consensus.
All right. Well, I'll see you when you get back. Okay. Maybe we'll have you come back up and you explain everything that happened
in
the veto session. Because if it's anything like the last couple of years, you're in for a good time.
We are.
Dan and I always enjoy seeing you. It's always fun when you come by. All right. Well, thanks for joining us on this special edition of High Plains Today. See you next time.
Keep up to date with the latest information from TV 23 on our Facebook page, KDGL TV.